everyone after lunch. Let's slowly get started. We are privileged to have our second keynote speech by Mohamed Saleh from Toulouse. Mohamed will take us on a journey to economic history, which I think is fantastic. We started this debate yesterday during the first keynote speech, to what extent economic history can be simplified, so we will find out. And personally, I've always been fascinated by economic history. I very much like the saying coined by Peter Thiel, who said, "I learn from my mistakes. I'm sure I can return them. I can repeat them exactly." So with that, I will pass on.
Okay. Good afternoon, everyone, and thanks a lot to Guido for organizing this and for inviting me to this fantastic event. Okay, so since this is a keynote lecture, I decided to add some slides in the beginning about economic history more generally, right? Not just about this specific topic that I'm gonna discuss. So as you see, I'm gonna talk a bit about a new economic history of the Middle East and North Africa. So of course, the first question that comes to one's mind is why economic history, right? So this is, as an economic historian, I'm very used to this question. I'm always on the defensive side, so I have to justify why I'm doing economic history. Of course, if you ask why economic history to a historian, it's quite obvious, like why do you ask such a question? But I think it's important to bear in mind this question, and for me as an economic historian, it was always a very useful question, actually, because with this kind of existentialist questions, you get to think more about your field and to understand exactly why do you do this research. So of course, this is a general question that goes beyond the Middle East. A very simple definition, perhaps oversimplified definition of economic history that doesn't say much, in fact, is that it's an interdisciplinary field that lies between economics and history. And although it's a very simple definition, but I think it has something to it, which is the interdisciplinarity idea, which I think is quite important and quite overlooked in the way economic history is practiced. So on the one hand, economic history uses economic theory and uses quantitative methods, or what I would call the social science approach to history, which is based on this positivist idea of history that you take empirical facts as they happen. You assume that there are facts out there, there are historical facts, and you try to make sense out of them. And then moreover, you use also quantitative methods, not just assuming that there are facts, but you also use quantitative methods. And plus using economic theory to understand history. So that's the social science contribution, or the economics contribution. But then on the other hand, of course, there is the history side, and one typical answer to why people should study economic history is that history provides this wider laboratory to carry out empirical research in social sciences. So if you think about it, it seems quite obvious to me, like, why do you only focus in doing empirical research on this specific contemporary point in time? This point in time, it's contemporary, but it's obviously changing. So what you do now using data from 2016 will be history in 10 years or 20 years from now, anyways. And on the other hand, history actually, just by definition, it gives you a wider laboratory, so you can use any since you're a social scientist, you can use any data from any episode in this longer time framework. One thing that is nice about history is that historical events are quite unique and rich, so there are things that you cannot study except by looking at history. Where else can you find things like slavery? Where else can you study things like fall of empires? So these are very big events that you can only examine if you look at history. On the other hand, long-run changes are quite fascinating and are also quite challenging to model. So I believe that our economic theory is still not there yet. So we cannot explain institutional change in a dynamic way that is adequate, essentially. We cannot indigenize completely the institutional changes that are happening. But also one other aspect of history that is important, apart from being a laboratory to carry out empirical research, is that we can use history also to improve on economic theory. And there are many examples of this in the past. If you think about early great economists, Schumpeter, for example, Simon Kuznets, these were economic historians in a sense. And economic history provides very rich situations which can be used to model and to improve on economic theory. So that's the answer I would give to economists, but at the same time you should give an answer to historians also. Why do you care about economic history? So you might be surprised also to know that there was a shift also in history in the last 30 years, just in the opposite direction of the shift that happened in economics, and history shifted away more to cultural studies, more to narratives that assume that there are no facts out there, and anti-quantification, and not only anti-quantification, but anti-positivism in general, or anti-the existence of empirical facts. So I believe that the answer would be that the social sciences approach to history is quite important and is actually quite complementary to historical research. So I'm not going to take the stance that social science is just superior to the humanities approach, because also I think that that's an exaggerated statement. But at the same time, I think it's quite complementary and they can work together. So enough of this general introduction, but we can shift to why economic history of the MENA region. So on the one hand, I think history of the MENA region still shapes its present, and there are many examples of this, in fact. So you can think of religious and ethnic conflicts. If you want to study ethnic and religious conflicts in any deep sense in the Middle East, you have to go to history, otherwise you won't be able to understand what is going on. Also, if you want to understand the changes that happened in, if you want to understand the Islamic revival, if you want to understand what do we mean exactly by Islam now, these are things that did not come out of the sky. You know, these are things that evolved over long centuries, and they were endogenous choices made by Asians along very long time periods, and their responses or the equilibria that were created in these religious beliefs varied over time and also across places. So it's not just a static notion of Islam or a static notion of Christianity and so on. Also persistence of institutions, many institutional arrangements in Islam have persisted until today. Taxation is one example, waqf is another example, and so on. And persistence of local elites, which is also quite striking, but this is not only limited to the Middle East. At the same time, history of the region could also teach us something about understanding the world, in fact, because there are many interesting and unique events in the Middle East that are quite important to study. For example, it offers this different form of feudalism in the Middle Ages that was quite different from Western Europe. Military feudalism, but at the same time the farmers had some kind of civil rights, so they were not completely enslaved in a sense, or completely enserfed, to be specific. Taxation also is quite important. In the Middle East there was taxation on religious choices, for example, which is quite unique, that you do not find in other taxation systems. The individualism of Islamic law is very important. It's very not unique per se, but it's this combination of individualism and collectivism is unique, I would say. So there are many things I think that can be used to understand better the world. So I'm going to just summarize in two slides. This is just for brainstorming, and by the way, feel free to interrupt anytime. So I should have mentioned that in the beginning if you have any questions or comments. Yes, so that's what I have to put some fancy terminology so that you ask and then I answer. So cleometrics is basically, I guess you know metrics, it means measurement, and cleo means history. So it just means economic history, but done in a rigorous quantitative way. Quantitative economic history. Fogel, yes. So this is a new economic history that emerged in the 1950s and 60s as a way to quantify history. But so far, most of this use of quantitative methods in history has been mostly limited to North America and to North America and Western Europe. Of course, the main reason for that is the lack of data, right? This is a statement that is always said. Economic history of the MENA region has been shaped by early historians who have done fascinating work, but they were not quantitative in the sense that they do not use econometrics, for example. But still, they were quantitative in the sense that they would collect data, they are positivist, and so on. So one of the main figures is Eliyahu Ashter, Charles Essawi, and among others. But despite this, I guess one major feature or one major limitation of the economic history of the MENA region so far is that it mostly focused on these macro and institutional questions, the big questions, I would say. So the main question is why the Middle East lagged behind Western Europe? Why didn't the Industrial Revolution occur in the Middle East? These are the kind of questions, the big questions that, of course, should be at the back of our minds. But the problem is that, or not the problem, but I would say the limitation is that the quantitative economic history of the region has been mostly limited to this area. Another thing is that the data sources that were used to quantify the economic history of the region so far has been mostly drawing on Ottoman and or colonial sources. Of course, there are some exceptions. So there is some, including Eliyahu Ashter, by the way, who has done or used data sources from the pre-Ottoman period. But in general, there is a bias towards using the Ottoman sources because, of course, one reason is that it's more recent, so there are more sources. Another reason is that it's more accessible, the Turkish archives and so on. So the last point is about qualitative historians who increasingly shifted to cultural history, but at the same time, there is a revival of social and economic history among historians of the Middle East. Based on this situation, I think these are, in my mind, these are the main challenges that faces the economic history of the region. First thing is that the pre-Ottoman Middle East, which is quite crucial in the evolution of the Islamic institutions in the Middle East, has received only modest attention from quantitative economic historians. Second is that the non-Ottoman local archives, including the Egyptian archives or the Levantine archives and so on, they were rarely used, in fact. So most of the stuff focuses only on the Ottoman stuff. There is also almost complete dichotomy between the pre-Islamic institutions and the post-Arab conquest institutions. And I think that's it's quite a big limitation in my view. So if you see a paper, for example, on wages in Roman Egypt, you will not think of it as the Middle East, right? You'll be surprised to know that most of the evidence on which the stuff we know about the Roman Empire is actually not based from Rome, it's actually based on Egypt. So it's, but we don't think of it as the Middle East, right? Because we are trained to think of the world based on the religious division of the Middle Ages, essentially. So that's why we don't think of Roman Egypt as Egypt now. It belongs to the West somehow. And finally, that there is this separation between local scholars who do fascinating work, but usually in Arabic or Turkish or Persian, and scholars in Western academia. So based on this, I think I have some thoughts on basically that we need first to bridge this gap between the pre-Islamic institutions and the post-Arab conquest. I think So one example I will bring up is this taxation system, for example. I said in the beginning that the taxation system in the Middle East is quite unique because it taxed religion, essentially, or religious choices. But actually, if you go back in time a little bit, you will see that the Roman Empire also imposed a tax, and this tax was removed if you become a Roman citizen. So, and it was a per head tax as well. So it's very similar, right? The idea is there, like once you become one of us, whatever this us means, you will be exempted from this taxation. So it's very important to think about these continuities, I believe. The other thing is that we need to build more evidence from micro data sources and not only focus on the big questions. Because I think that if you look at the economic history of the US or Western Europe or so, there is really a huge amount of micro evidence that has been collected over many years before they got to the big questions, right? And I think that, or maybe the two go together, hand in hand, but you cannot think only of the Middle East as in relevance or relative in, or in comparison to Western Europe and the US. So it has to be taken seriously. It has to be studied using micro sources on its own. And I think there are many, both Ottoman and non-Ottoman archival and primary sources that could be used for this purpose. And the data are actually out there, but it's just that it takes time to digitize them, and people usually are reluctant to take this efforts. So these include population censuses, tax registers, but also some sources that are not readily considered as data sources. And here I brought some examples of this. So for example, the Ottoman population censuses in 1881 to 1914, this is massively underused, for example, although the paper today was showing or using some of the 1914 census and the 1921. Yes, okay. The colonial population censuses, of course, are quite important, but also if you look back in time to the cadastral surveys, the tax registers, which predate the population censuses, which count only adult free men who are taxpayers. These are a very important source of data, and they are right there at the archives, but somebody has to go and actually do the work. The other source that I want to bring up is the papyri documents. So papyri documents, if we want to look at the pre-Ottoman period in particular, papyri and archaeological records, in my view, they provide rare source for examining the microhistory. And interestingly, they remain mostly unpublished. So most of these papyri, we're talking about like 100,000 Arabic papyri, and not also including the pre-Islamic papyri, which is huge, but it belongs to a totally different field, which is classics. If you think of these together, like as a continuous evolution of institutions of the Middle East, then you have this massive source of data that right now is used only by archaeologists and papyrologists, but social scientists, I believe, could do more by looking at these data sources. One nice thing about the papyri is that these are mostly administrative documents. Not all of them, of course, but mostly they are administrative documents, so they are neutral in a sense, or they reflect the point of view of the administration. But still, I would think that using them is perhaps more unbiased than just using the historical narratives, which are usually loaded with ideologies. If you look at, for example, list of taxpayers, converts, and so on. So finally, I think that collaboration with papyrologists and other people who are mostly working in humanities, I think it's a must, actually, if we want to take this field forward and if we want to really make our understanding of the area more deeper, in a sense. So that said, I will move on now to the paper that I wanted to present. So this paper is, so of course now I raised your expectations very high, now I have to get them low again. So this paper is about a very specific episode in 19th century rural Egypt. I'm not going to talk about pre-Islamic institutions here. And I'm not going to talk about the papyri, but like I can talk about it in the coffee break or in the Q&A, or if you have questions. Okay, so this is the outline, but I guess I'll have to go through it like at a relatively high speed because I'm not sure how I'm doing on time. Okay, so this paper is basically motivated by three lines of literature. The first line of literature is coercion of labor. So many contracts in labor history, especially in agriculture, were coercive in the sense that force was used to induce the worker to accept something that, or to accept a contract that he or she would not accept otherwise. And one reason for coercion of labor, the classical reason that is offered out there is labor scarcity. So the idea here is that if labor is relatively scarce compared to land, then labor is, of course, highly valuable. Under competitive labor markets, wages will go up really high. So if there is a land-owning class that wants to have positive rents from land, they have to use coercion in order to depress the wages. And this has been documented in many cases. For example, if you think about slavery in the US South or in the Caribbean, it was mainly because of scarcity of labor, of white labor. In a labor-scarce environment, when you have exogenous output price shocks, which would lead to these massive increases in labor demand, this was often correlated with this increase in coercion of labor. So you have a positive shock in cotton prices, which what I'm going to talk about, or in other output prices, and then you see increase in coercion, although it should lead to increase in wages, but it's often the case that it doesn't, and instead it increases coercion.
Could you just highlight that mechanism, because it must mean that in the times where you don't have scarce labor, you are rationally not using coercion.
Exactly. So I think the idea is if you have, let's think that labor is now the abundant source compared to land. In that case, you will have this endless resource of unskilled labor in agriculture that you could hire. And so you don't need really to use coercion because wages are very low. They are anyways kept at the subsistence wage. And that's the case in many or most developing countries nowadays. But back in the day, historically, or in many situations, that was not the case. It was actually labor that was more valuable than land.
But
so if you want to have
the cost of coercion,
Yes.
That's really special.
The
wages are not
zero,
so you're not using coercion because there is some cost.
Well, I think the idea here is that, so in this framework, coercion is taken as, you have to assume that there is some institutional framework, essentially, that allows coercion. So that's, yes, exactly.
And creating this, or maintaining this framework is costly.
Exactly, yeah.
It's probably also a public good.
Yeah, so changes in terms of trade, so that's the second line of literature that is motivating this paper is trade and institutions. So it has been shown in various cases that changes in terms of trade could affect institutional arrangements, including coercion of labor. So for example, the transatlantic trade and the rise of property rights in Europe, the rise of impersonal exchange. One very important hypothesis is the famous Engerman and Sokolov hypothesis on initial factor endowments and how they led to this institutional divergence between Latin America and North America. Third, there is this literature, a vast literature actually, on the economics of slavery in the US South and in the Caribbean and in Latin America. So by the way, this is the earliest economic history literature that motivated or was part of this cleometrics revolution in the 19th 60s onwards. Slavery there emerged mostly because of scarcity of labor, and also there was always this increase in demand for slave labor once you have a positive price shock. So when you have increase in cotton prices in particular, for example, in the 1830s, there is this increase in slavery. Also, it has been observed that there are differences between crops in technology which might account for these differences in demand for slave versus free labor across crops. You have some crops that are usually thought of as being slave crops, in a sense, which are usually cotton, tobacco, and sugar, and versus other crops that essentially require free labor. And the idea here is, one of the hypotheses is, if the crop requires effort-intensive tasks versus care-intensive tasks. So if it requires effort-intensive tasks, then you should, or you could only induce workers to work via corporal punishments, essentially, rather than rewards. So this paper tries to contribute to this literature. It tries to documents the impact of labor demand shocks, which are induced by these international price shocks, on the demand for free labor and for slave labor. The paper uses what I think of as a unique historical case study, which is quite rich. So this case study is the cotton boom that occurred during the American Civil War between 1861 and 1865. So during this period, the cotton prices went up, and essentially Egypt and India and Brazil were major producers of cotton at the time, so they benefited from the price boom. And historians documented that this cotton boom marked the emergence of slavery in Egyptian agriculture. Up to 1848, or around that time, farmers were previously coerced by the state. So the state was the sole monopolist, essentially, over the export crop markets. And it was the one who decided which crops are planted and forcing farmers to plant this specific acreage of each crop. Then there was this liberation of agricultural labor that started in the 1840s. And interestingly, this liberation coincided with the rise in imported slavery in response to the cotton boom. As I'm going to show you, slaves were mainly owned by landholding farmers. They were both village headmen, but also other medium landholding farmers who were not essentially part of the elite. The paper is using novel data sources. The main source I'm using here is the 1848 and 1868 individual level population census samples. So these are two of the earliest population censuses in the Middle East that contain individual level data on every household member, including females, children, and slaves. And I'm combining these data with agricultural data from various primary sources and various published statistical reports. Finally, besides the cotton boom, I'm also contrasting this with an earlier price boom that happened in cereals just in the decade before, in the 1850s, that apparently did not lead to an increase in demand for slave labor. So to give you an idea about the magnitude, this is a graph that shows the export prices of cotton in Alexandria port in Egypt from 1820 onwards. And you see this increase in, so there is no pointer, I guess, but you could see that there is this increase in cotton prices in the 1860s. Of course, there is an earlier increase in the 1830s, but at that time, still the state was the only monopolist. So it could coerce farmers instead. If you look at the quantity produced and quantity exported of cotton, you see this massive expansion in cotton cultivation during the Civil War period. So it almost quadrupled the quantity produced of cotton during that period. And it remained at a very high level despite the decline that happened afterwards in cotton prices. So during that time, this is one of my favorite quotes. So it's saying that the barbarism of the US South, while destroying itself, appeared in the providence of God to be working out the regeneration of Egypt. And this was published by the North American Review during the Civil War, actually. It's in 1864. So here they were referring to the idea that Egypt benefited from the cotton boom by expanding on its cotton cultivation. But the side effect they did not think about is that historians documented that this cotton boom marked the emergence of agricultural slavery. So here, when I say emergence, I have to be careful. So I'm not talking about emergence of slavery as an institution in itself, because slavery existed in the Middle East for a very long time before the cotton boom. However, before the boom, most slaves in Egypt and in the Middle East at large were urban, and they mainly worked in domestic and in sexual services. So 75% of the slaves were females. Of course, another type of slavery was military slavery, which existed even before the 19th century. It was the dominant form of slavery in the Middle Ages. So you have slaves employed as officers or soldiers in the army. But this stopped by 1822 in Egypt. Now, what happened with the cotton boom is that you have this increase in slavery. Slaves were mostly imported from East Africa, from Sudan, Chad, and Ethiopia via slave raids. And then there was the abolition of slavery in 1877. So we're really talking about a short window of time in which there was slavery. Long staple cotton was introduced to Egypt in 1821. Since 1821 and until 1842, as I said, the state was the monopolist of most cash crops. So long staple cotton during that period had to rely on local labor, and coercion of farmers was going on in public works and in agriculture. There was also control on farmers' mobility, so you could not leave your village without state permit. Monopoly ended in 1842. So at that date, farmers started to be allowed to trade freely and to interact freely with traders from Alexandria and other areas. This was a period of important changes. So also there was this increase in land consolidation that happened, and land was given to those who could pay taxes, in a sense increasing the inequality in land holding starting from the 1840s. This figure is far from perfect. It just gives you some idea of what we know about slave imports. These are not administrative records. These are just based on estimates, rough estimates, often very wild estimates by European observers at the time. So you could see that annually the number of slaves that were imported ranged between 5,000 and 10,000. There was an increase in 1821 because of the invasion of Sudan, but most of these slaves were used in the army at that time, just for a short period, and then conscription was introduced. But then the massive increase in slave imports happened in the 1860s. So we have about 30,000 slaves being imported into Egypt annually during that period. Egypt's other major export crops during that period were also cereals, mostly wheat and beans. Beans is not really cereals, it's legumes, but it's okay. So cereals witnessed an earlier price boom in the 1850s, and that was because of the Crimean War. So also cereals exports tripled during that period. And there was an agricultural expansion and expansion in demand for labor, but cereals did not lead to a surge in importing slaves. So here you could see the increase that happened in cereal prices during the 1850s, and it continued actually at a high level afterwards, and you could see the increase in exports during the 1850s. Okay, so just to give you a brief idea of the main findings, and then I will discuss a bit of the data and the empirical strategy. So the main findings of the paper so far is the following. First, I find that the cotton favorable districts witnessed a differential increase in the demand for slave labor between 1848 and 1868 compared to the cotton non-cotton favorable districts. Slavery was non-existent in these districts before the cotton boom. So essentially, the use of agricultural slaves in these areas seemed to be at the extensive margin, not only at the intensive margin. There was no slavery to begin with in the rural areas that planted cotton. Landless farmers became landholding farmers because of the expansion of the cultivated land during that period. Interestingly, the cereal favorable districts did not witness an increase in demand for slave labor. So it's only cotton that led to this increase in demand for slave labor. So the mechanism, this is the part that is still in progress, but these are the ideas I have so far to make sense of these results. First thing is that labor scarcity could explain why labor demand shocks translate into labor coercion, and there is very good and well-documented historical evidence on scarcity of labor, which could also be supported with quantitative data from the censuses. Before the boom, the government responded to this scarcity of labor and in order to depress wages by coercion of local labor. Now, what happened in, that's the story I have in mind so far, is that the relaxation of state control over the local farmers and the shift of power that happened during the 1840s to the landholding farmers may explain why the landholding farmers, when the cotton boom occurred, had to resort to importing slaves.
So this goes back to my initial question.
Yeah.
Are you considering the relaxation of state control a force that is exogenous to the cotton boom?
Yes.
And
because it happened before.
Oh,
yeah.
Great. And then it seems that the fact that now the, you know, decentrally, mm-hmm. coercion would have been, there would have been a need to organize decentrally coercion.
Right.
And this seems to be that there is like economies of scale in organizing coercion, right? It's quite.
Which coincides with this
and that
land
makes sense,
consolidation.
Right? So it's
yeah.
Getting too expensive to organize coercion on the decentral level.
Yeah.
And that would give, okay.
Yeah. Finally, that the impact of, okay, sorry.
Could the labor scarcity at that period also be explained by the construction of the Suez Canal, which started in 1859 up to 1869?
Very good question. That's the problem with that, okay, so this is one thing that is documented by some historian, that there was this massive corvée in the Suez Canal during that period. From my view, based on the data, I think that view is quite exaggerated, actually, in the historical narratives. And the reason is that this use of corvée labor or forced labor in public works was always done from the 1820s onwards. So there was no specific change that happened because of the construction of the Suez Canal. At least it's not really reflected in the data. Final thing is that the impact of the price shocks could vary by crop, and that's how I could explain these differences in the response to wheat versus cotton booms, because of differences in technology of production. Here I mean exactly the differences in effort, intensity, and in the increasing returns to scale. So in terms of contribution, I think this is a concrete historical experiment where a positive trade shock caused an increase in demand for slave labor. One of the first quantitative studies of slavery in the Middle East, which so far remained mostly a black box in terms of quantitative studies. And I think that changes in labor coercion, which I think I'm still working on, but the changes in labor coercion and the fact that the state lost its position as the major monopolist over the farmers in the 1840s, I think that that distinguishes the Egyptian context from the New World type of slavery. It's not that you have a land-owning class that was always resorting to slavery. It's also the change that happened in who was the main monopolist or who was the main producer of cotton during that period. Okay, so I think I have 15 minutes or?
Precisely.
Yeah? Okay, okay, so since I'm a historian, I'm gonna give you more history. Up to 1800, Egypt's agriculture was confined to winter crops, mainly wheat, barley, and beans, because of the reliance on the Nile inundation. Summer crops were usually confined to farms that were close to the Nile. What happened in the early 19th century is that there was an expansion in perennial irrigation that could provide water all year around because of the need to expand on summer cash crops. among these summer cash crops was, of course, long staple cotton that was discovered in 1821. This is just for visual entertainment, a photo for cotton harvest in Egypt. Muhammad Ali monopolized trade of all major cash crops between 1808 and 1842. After 1842, the farmers became connected to the world market as exporters were, for the first time, allowed to buy the produce directly from farmers. So I think I'm gonna skip that. This is just to show you the increase that happened in the share of cotton in the total value of exports. So you see how wheat was actually, or cereals had a higher share before the cotton boom, and then you see how cotton became about 80% of the cotton of the total exports of Egypt, and it remained as such, by the way, until mid-20th century. And this is to show you the total area cultivated. This is hard to see here, but the main thing is that cotton used to be 3% of the total land cultivated, and it almost quadrupled to 12%. But of course, the major shares are the cereals still. The important thing to that I will mention here is that slaves were of three colors, blacks, brown, and whites. But the vast majority of slaves used in agriculture and the vast majority of slaves in the 19th century were blacks. This is a photo for a black slave in Cairo slave market in 1864. And the supply of slaves came through these slave raids in Sudan and Chad. Slaves were raided by the government in 1821 to 45. So the government was actually organizing these raids, and it was a way to pay soldiers, actually. And then it resorted to private raiders because of Western pressure. Slave raids were concentrated in south of Nubia, mainly in Darfur, Kordofan, and Sennar, and it escalated during the cotton boom period. And this guy here is one of the major figures, actually, of the slave raiders. He's from North Sudan, and then he was raiding slaves in Darfur, and he made a fortune out of that, and he actually became the governor afterwards. So he's a very important figure. The data, as I said, come from the population census samples from 1848 and 1868. I aggregated these data to the household level. The sample sizes, the original sample size is about 80,000 observations in each census. But then I matched the rural districts, so I focus only on rural Egypt in this paper. I matched rural districts across 1848 and 1868. So we have 25 matched districts out of 71. And the reason is that the 1868 census was less complete than the 1848. However, if you compare the descriptive statistics in 1848 between those who are matched and the districts that were not matched, you don't find any statistical difference. This is a page, a scanned page from one of the census registers. So it has the individual level records in Arabic manuscript. And this is an example from the digitized sample. So you could see it's quite detailed. It tells the name of the person, his male, slave, able-bodied, 25 years under the government's control, brown color, medium height, and then it has also some facial description. It also gives the address of the person and the dwelling information. Yeah, I'm not using the non-connected eyebrows in the okay, so
the tribe information, how detailed is that? So tribe or sub-tribe, how big is that?
Oh, the Arab tribes.
Yeah.
The Arab tribes are also mentioned in exactly the same way, so you will have the specific registers for Arab tribes. It will be also at the individual level, household by household, and then they will say which sub-group in the tribe they belong to and where they are located also.
Yeah, but sub-tribe is how big? Several thousand people?
I don't know on the top of my head now, but I think fewer than that, I would say. Yeah. Much fewer. I can
say that. It's also very detailed information on ethnicity.
Yeah. But the tribes are not that big. You have to bear that in mind. In Egypt, it's not really a tribal society. So the empirical strategy, what I'm going to show you now is a reduced form empirical strategy, but I'm going to discuss in a second. So the first empirical strategy is that I regress YIJT, which is essentially the outcome of household I living in district J in year T. And this outcome is a measure of slavery, which I'm going to discuss. Maybe right now. So there are three outcomes of interest I'm interested in. The first is the demand for imported slave labor, which is the number of slaves in the household, and an indicator variable if the household has at least one slave, so to capture both the intensive and the extensive margins. Then I'm also trying to capture the demand for free local labor. So I don't have wages, I don't have information on wages in the census. So what I do here is that I use an indicator if the household head is an immigrant, if the household head is a landholding farmer, landless farmer, or sharecropper. So I try to capture the four types of, or the three types at least, the landholding farmer, landless farmers, and sharecroppers of agricultural labor at the time. Then I also use other outcomes that are at the district level, not at the household level, such as the area cultivated by cotton, by cereals, and some measures of capital. So this outcome is regressed on district fixed effects because I have a panel of districts. A post-boom indicator variable, which captures the 1868 census, and then the interaction of a measure of favorability to cotton with the post-boom indicator. This measure of cotton favorability is time invariant, so it's a measure of geographic suitability to cotton. And then I control for some district level and household level characteristics. In another specification, I also try to control for the favorability to cereals in order to capture this variation between cereals and cotton. So I call this empirical strategy one. Empirical strategy two, which I'm not going to show you today, is using cotton cultivation as an outcome in a first stage, measured by the output of cotton or the land cultivated of cotton. And then in the second stage, regressing the number of slaves or the other outcomes on the cultivation of cotton. And I do the same thing for cereals. And the idea here is to capture if the outcomes are due to changes in cultivation of cotton versus cereals. So of course, the natural question now is, what is my measure of cotton favorability? So far, I use four measures. One is an indicator if the district was cotton growing district based on an agricultural survey conducted in 1844 before the cotton boom. Second, I use the length of summer canals, which is a good predictor of where cotton is planted. So the length of summer canals per acre, essentially, if it then is like almost equivalent to an acre in 1840, number of water wheels per fedan, also based on an agricultural survey in 1840. Then if you think that these measures are all endogenous for one reason or another, then I also use temperature as a predictor of cotton. So this map shows you the district's favorability to cotton and cereals in 1840. So the first one shows the cotton's yield per fedan, or essentially if cotton is planted or not. So you could see that cotton was concentrated in the Nile Delta in the north. So there was no cotton in the Nile Valley. But then you get more variation if you use the length of summer canals per fedan in the panel C, or the number of water wheels per fedan. But in general, you see that summer irrigation was more provided more in the Nile Delta compared to the Nile Valley. So this table actually is the major, it summarizes really the one of the major findings of the paper so far, which is the percentage of slaves, the slave population share. And here I'm contrasting just the Nile Valley versus the Nile Delta. This is a very simple diff-and-diff table. And you could see that in 1848, in the Nile Valley, which was not growing cotton, if anything, the percentage of slaves was higher than in the Nile Delta. And more importantly, the percentage of slaves in the Nile Delta was almost negligible. It almost doesn't exist. But now if you move forward to 1868, you see this increase in slavery in the Nile Delta from almost nothing to about 5% of the population, while in the Nile Valley there is almost no change. Right. So when you get this, it's reassuring because even without controlling for anything, you see that the control districts more or less did not witness changes in slavery. So I think I will have to wrap up. I don't want to torture you with all these tables, but essentially they say all the same story. So whether I use an indicator for cotton growing district or length of summer canals and other measures of cotton favorability, you always get this positive and significant coefficient on the interaction of cotton with the 1868 indicator. Here in this table, my dependent variable is the number of slaves in the household. Also controlling for cereals, you get the same thing, and cereals itself is not statistically significant. And you could see that the demand for slaves came mainly from landholding farmers. So it was really an agricultural type of slavery. If you look at, if I break them down by male slaves versus female slaves and also by age group, the main result is that the increase happened mainly in male black slaves who age 15 to 29. So essentially, this is in contrast to the urban slavery, which was mostly females. So that's the main essence of that final table. Demand for free local labor, if I use an indicator for immigrant or an indicator for the household head being a landholding farmer, sharecropper, or landless farmer, you see that there is some effect on the share of immigrants. So there are indeed free immigrants who came to these districts. Also in the share of landholding farmers, but this appears to be that some landless farmers actually switched to become landholding farmers because of the expansion in the land cultivated of cotton. Interestingly, there is no increase in the share of sharecroppers during that period in the cotton growing districts. So let me skip this. This is just to show you the effect on the cotton cultivation and also on the cereal cultivation. So you see that the expansion happened mainly in cotton, not in cereal. So this is, in a sense, my first stage regression. Uh, So how to make sense out of this? So to wrap up, as I mentioned in the beginning, I argue that this shortage of local labor led to the emergence of these coercive institutions in order to have positive rents from land. While the state coerced local labor because it had the means to do so in the early period, farmers had to resort to importing slaves later on. Of course, what I have to do next is to collect more evidence on wages in particular. Right now, what I have is province-level data on wages. It shows that there is some modest increase in nominal wages. It's not clear yet if this increase is real or not. I would not be surprised if there was some increase in wages, and there is this increase in migration and so on. But apparently, they had to suppress the wages beyond a certain level and to import these slaves. So this is to conclude. So this paper, I think, it analyzes this case study from 19th century Egypt that may shed light on the reasons behind the emergence for demand in of slave labor in certain crops, but not in other crops, using these new data sources, which could be used for many other purposes as well. I think that there is more research to be done on the institution of coercion of local labor, and that's what I'm researching at this stage. So, thank you very much.
Thank you. We have a few minutes for questions, if there are questions. And yes, please. And Simon, yeah, let's start with.
Just very quickly, it was very interesting. Thank you, Mohamed. I have a question to you, though, which is, I mean, obviously, you see that there's a market for cotton. Cotton is very labor intensive, and this in your framework drives much of the story. But why do farmers, or why does the structure pick slavery and not some form of serfdom, for instance? I mean, there are landless people around, they're sharecroppers as well, so why didn't they pick an arrangement which gave them some rights over land and some payments in product terms, rather than slavery, for which the transaction cost must have been extremely high? In other words, bringing the slaves in, managing them and so on, paying traders and the like. So my question is, why that choice? Do you have any ideas?
Yeah, so that's a great question. This is essentially the thing that I am researching now, like why there was no response in coercion of landless farmers. My initial thought on this is that previously it was the state who could actually coerce the landless farmers and the landholding farmers as well by forcing them to this corvée labor because it has the army and it has the force to do so. The farmers, when they started to become the producers, and they not only the producers, but they could also trade their crops, I think they lacked the means of doing so. And I think it was the case that the slavery market was more organized and it was actually easier to get a slave because it was already established in urban areas. So you could just go to the market in the local village and buy a slave rather than trying to use force to coerce a landless farmer in your village or even a landholding farmer to farm your own land. So I think it was the response in that sense happened easier in slavery. But that's my initial response. Of course, I have to research more on the dynamics of the coercion of local labor during that episode.
So I realize this is a historical paper, but since we know there's this literature on very persistent effects on both destination and source countries of slavery on labor market institutions, trust, and other outcomes, I was just wondering whether you are at least tempted to try to sort of extend some of your results to the present day, or perhaps you expect that this was a very short-lived, a very small, quite small-scale boom in boom period in terms of cotton and slavery. So it may not be useful to even try to do that. But yeah. I would like to hear your view on that. Thanks.
Okay. Yeah. So so of course I've thought about that before, but I think I think you answered the question basically. So because it's a short-lived institution, I don't think it had these long-lasting effects on the per se. Like the slavery itself did not have these long-lasting effects. That said, I believe that there are other aspects of the labor organization in these areas, in the cotton growing areas, that might have persisted, in particular the hierarchical organization of labor in cotton cultivating regions. So some of the long-term effects you could think about is how hierarchical it became afterwards, the labor, with a percentage of landless farmers, for example, and so on. But also another aspect I'm interested in is gender inequality, actually. So you could think that cotton, despite the fact that it's a slave-conducive crop in a sense, but it's also gender egalitarian because it recruits both females and males, in contrast to sugar, which was more prevalent in the south of Egypt, which is a very man-dominated crop. So this is some of the, but it's not slavery per se. Yeah.
Let's collect a few questions round, starting with maybe Jamal and Bob, but very quickly. And
yeah, can I pick up on this? So one question I have is to what extent you see differential fertility in cotton-intensive versus cereal-intensive areas, because you might expect that if the demand for labor increases, and this is sort of gender neutral, then the opportunity cost of women's time increases, and that this should have a negative impact on fertility. And there's sort of cross-country evidence suggesting that this is the case, at least, you know, if you look at manufacturing industries. So maybe this could be like a robustness check.
Can we differentiate between, is it a demand story or a supply story? Is it, do we have the increase in the demand for labor for the slaves, or is it an increase in the supply of slaves? Do we know where they are coming from, what was happening in their origin, etc.?
Yeah, I actually had a similar question. Do we know anything about price of a slave during that period?
I wonder if you could in a position to comment on the longer term impact of this in two respects. First of all, in terms of Egyptian society, and secondly, in terms of quality of product. My impression is that the long staple cotton had been very successfully introduced before this period, and that more might have meant worse in the sense that the overall quality declined. But I'd be interested in any comments you may.
The quality of
The cotton.
Of cotton declined.
And therefore its place, Egypt's place in world markets.
Hmm.
I was going to ask you, as an historian, how much you relied on narrative accounts to back up your quantitative census data. So I'm thinking of data. I'm thinking of government reports or even traveller, you know, 19th century traveller accounts of what was going on to give a more granular picture. And in the context of what the follow-up was, I'm wondering why and under what circumstances slavery was abolished in 1877, and in that respect, I think you're implying that actually this incident, it was relatively limited, actually had a positive impact on land ownership within Egypt. Is that right? Thank you. Longer term.
So if I were to think of this in the current day, so at least in the literature I know better, the one on conflict. This idea that resource windfalls, as driven by increasing the international price for labor-intensive commodities, they're basically conducive to less conflict because people are empowered. So they get better wages and the opportunity cost increases. So, I mean, they're less likely to go on conflict. That's pretty much I mean, you're now documenting a different effect I've never thought of. So if I'm thinking of today, what I'm wondering is simply, so is it different today because institutions no longer permit slavery? Because there is no longer shortage of supply of workers? Or perhaps should I think that maybe in disguised form, in very autocratic regimes, is it still true that people actually still today? And then secondly, is a comment on the instrument. So as for the measures of crop suitability, I guess, so my guess is, well, besides those that are to me clearly endogenous, and then you go to temperature, I was wondering whether you should just straight use the soil suitability from FAO. I guess that's very persistent over time, so I don't know what you get today, perhaps is what is back. And I guess it's, at least to me, I guess it could be an alternative to the temperature for which the exclusion restriction might be violated. So simply you have less slaves where, I don't know how much variation there is in temperature within Egypt. Plus, it could be the case that, slaves are less profitable when it's too hot, right? Whereas, so.
Yes, I want to go back to your general points on the economic history of the region. Whether how you rate Braudel, who dealt with the Mediterranean as a whole, and was criticized for being structuralist and not too much focus on culture.
Well, I think you have about 47 seconds per question, and then we'll break for coffee.
That's a lot. Okay, so these are all great questions. Thanks for this. Let me.
35.
Out of time, right? Okay, so I'm just trying to remember which ones I think I answered the persistent effects on slavery. Yes, so it was then a question about the fertility, if I can observe differences in, I think it's you who asked here, differences in fertility. So of course, bear in mind that this is before the demographic transition, so the mortality is child mortality is very high, and it's still interesting to look at that. So one thing one of the controls I'm using now is the number of children in the household. I'm also using that as a control, but it could be used as an outcome. So this is something that could be looked at. However, I don't have number of children ever born, so it's not a perfect measure of fertility. What I have is number of surviving children who are residing in the same household. Yeah, that's the problem, because when you don't have a number of children ever born, then you get to this, it's not a perfect measure. Yeah. Whether it's a demand story or a supply story, I think I'm leaning more towards the demand story, because the supply, of course the supply increased, but it increased in response to this initial increase in demand. So there was this increasing number of slave raids during that period, but it happened as documented in response to that, the fact that there was this cotton boom and the farmers, they knew that the farmers needed slaves. Price of slaves, interestingly, did not go up during that period. However, we have a very bad and limited data on prices. If we take it seriously, it might mean that slaves were really abundant somehow, so that there was no response. And I think that's supported by the historical evidence during that period. There was really a big supply, especially in Darfur, actually, during that period. Long-term effects of this, and whether it, if I understood correctly, if the expansion led to this drop in quality of cotton cultivation. So of course, cotton, the quality of Egyptian cotton varied during that period. The problem was that when they introduced any new type of cotton, the quality dropped quite rapidly, and then they had to introduce new seeds, or I'm not an expert in agriculture, but that's what I understood. But there is nothing specific about this expansion in terms of drop in quality. Whether I used the narratives, this is something I had to skip quite fast, but this paper is actually building on very important narratives by historians of the region. So I'm not the very first one to ask this question. This was actually noticed by historians as early as in 1926 or even by contemporary eyewitnesses and travelers and so on. And then more recently, there are historians who work on Egypt, Ahmed Hilal and Kenneth Kuno, who actually looked at this question, and they also used the census data, but since they don't have samples, what they did is that they looked at specific villages that were known to grow cotton, and then they documented the increase in the number of slaves in these villages, but without having like a control group or like saying to compare it to what. Abolition of slavery and I think abolition of slavery was mainly for political pressure. Basically, it was enforced by European powers. The clergy in Egypt was actually very much against the abolition of slavery. The religious clergy were really mad about it, and this is well documented actually, because it's allowed, of course, slavery in Islam. But I have to mention enslavement of fellow Muslims is not allowed in Islam. So that's why slaves had to be imported from outside, because they have to be infidels essentially at the time of the enslavement or the time of captivity. And then slavery was inherited, of course, afterwards. Whether the increase in prices, it leads to this decline in conflicts, and this seems to be contradictory to this. I agree. I think here the major thing is the institutional framework. If the institutional framework allows slavery to begin with, and the scarcity of labor story. I think once you have the demographic transition, that you have this massive expansion in the population, then I don't think it makes much sense to rely on slavery, because you could get wage labor for very little wages anyways. They are all over the place, and that's why in Egypt and in many other areas you have a phenomenon of very unskilled labor who are totally mobile, and then they go from one place to the other for the harvest and so on, and it's very easy to pay them wages because they get very little anyways. So I don't think in that framework you really need to use coercion. And in that sense, maybe wages will go up. It will be beneficial to them. The FAO database, I get this question a lot. So the reason I don't use it is because the FAO database is very good when it comes to rain-based agriculture, but not to irrigation-based agriculture. And so it gives some suitability measures of crops using the specific amount of rain and so on, as if this is the primitive way of agriculture. This applies to many countries like India, Brazil, for example. That doesn't apply to Egypt, because in Egypt everything is human-made. And when it comes to Egypt, the network they use or the map they use is based on 1961. And if you look at 1961, this was already an irrigation map that is totally different from the 19th century. So I think my measures of the summer canals are actually better, because they capture the irrigation network back in the 19th century, at least, compared to 1961, which would be outrageous, I think, to argue that this is exogenous. And then the last question was regarding Brodel. And so, of course, this is a big debate, what kind of to what extent are we allowed to use structure in understanding history, and to what extent do we favor cultural explanations over structural or like more theory-oriented explanations? In my view, I think we need a bit of both. So I think we need, I think social scientists have to humble themselves by the fact that history is too complicated and we cannot always have the right short answer to everything. But at the same time, I think human minds, we always think of structuring things somehow, whether we like it or not. We always think of generalizations, we always think of explaining relationships and so on. So this is also, we cannot just rely on narratives in the sense of looking at individual narratives without having any structure. I don't think any historian does that, even if they use culture, actually.
Thank you very much. Rolf has an announcement before we...
Just very briefly, there will be a fire alarm check at 4:45. Just to warn you, it will be very loud. But there's no need to panic or to use it as an excuse to leave early. It will just take 30 seconds, and it will probably be during Simon's discussion, unfortunately. So we will just be, it's usually best to just, you know, sit, relax, and wait for a few seconds then, rather than try to continue talking, because it's quite loud. But it only takes 30 seconds, so just as a general warning. Okay. Let's break for coffee.
Well, on that note, let's give a round of applause. Reconvene in 15 minutes at 3:35, so that the alarm